principle, and not only principle but also followed. Of course, it needs courage to all these companies or the other actors to work together while they were used to a traditional way of working. So put all these resources together. Of course, you have again the reliability, which is important here too, and finally the gain, because this is a very exciting way of working together and bringing the best ideas to reality. As it was mentioned earlier, the idea is really to bring this idea to reality. So go from the research back to the bench, from the bench, sorry, to the patient side. So how does IMI work? We have two funding members which represent the governing board, which are the European Commission and the European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industry Association, and they have the overall responsibility for the operation of IMI. Then we have the executive director with staff that we are representing today, and we are really responsible for day-to-day management. I mean, really launching the call, evaluation, managing the project, dealing all the day-to-day with the IPR issues and so on and so forth. And we have the scientific committee. So these are really the governance body of IMI. The scientific committee is represented by 50 members, and they advise the governing board on the priority which are put together by the European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industry Association. These 15 members are scientific experts which come from member states and are recommended by the SRG, so the state representative group, and chosen of course by the governing board. So these are the two other external bodies which are as important as the one I just mentioned, which are the IMI state representative group, where we have one representative per member and associated states, and their role is really to play the interface with the stakeholder and to ensure communication between the stakeholders as well. So one of the chair of the IMI state representative is an observer in the governing board, which is the utmost instance at IMIGU. And then you have the stakeholder forum, which is a kind of meeting that is organized yearly, where annual meeting where all the stakeholders are invited to participate, where you have academic, SMEs, patient organization, regulators, and so on, which are invited to show, I mean, to listen to the different progress which has been done by IMI and to communicate to them this information and to get their feedback in order to make sure that we really have all the information necessary to continue our activities. Why do we need IMI? We are here as an autonomous body. As I mentioned, the executive office is really a neutral third party, and his role is really to ensure that a program is well implemented, that the activities is common to interest of patient, industry, and academy. So this is more than day-to-day management, as I mentioned earlier in the previous slide. So our role is also to monitor the combined use of public funds and industry investments, and of course to guarantee fair and reasonable conditions for optimal knowledge exploitation. And here we have today with us Magali Poineau, who is our legal advisor and the person who is completely in charge with managing the IP policy at IMIGU. Magali, tu fais coucou? Thank you. Okay. So as I mentioned, the research agenda is really this Bible, let's say, which describes the research bottleneck in drug development and makes some recommendations on how to solve these bottlenecks. So this has been the first document which has been issued in 2006, and which really it's really the Bible where the scientific priorities are taken, identified for the following calls for proposal. And this recommendation, of course, comes from an extensive consultation between Europe's and key stakeholders under the lead of European Federation of Pharmaceutical Industry Association. So we are in the process right now of reviewing this EMI research agenda, and this will be is done concomitantly with the EMI scientific committee. Okay. So this research agenda has identified four pillars which are of interest, where really bottlenecks needs to be addressed, is the pillar on safety and on efficacy in drug development process. And horizontally, we have these two other pillars which are also important, which are knowledge management, how to deal with the data which will be, collected from all this science and research, then how we can manage this, how we can put this available to the public, and of course education and training, knowing that there is a lot of emerging science and a lot of needs also coming from the EFPR association and industry, which needs some, trainees according to their needs. So it's very important to make sure that the program we are providing here answer the needs of the pharmaceutical industry, at least in the frame we are talking about. So what are the results expected from EMI? As I mentioned earlier, it's really supporting the pre-competitive pharmaceutical research and development, and this with keeping in mind that the only goal is really to accelerate the development of safer and more effective medicine for the patients. The modernization of the drug development process, which means that creating any new methodology, new technique, new approaches, better use of research results and data, and all this is really at the center of what we call the pre-competitive research. Okay? And of course, foster this collaboration between all stakeholders which were not used to work together, and facilitate this for them. So EMI is really here not to, with the aim of delivering new medicine, but really to address the challenges in drug development process. So if we see just one word with for the EMI intellectual property policy within EMI, as I mentioned earlier, we have our specialist here, so if you have any question, this could be answered. So the EMI policy is really aligned with the EMI objectives, which takes in mind that we have to promote the knowledge creation, to facilitate disclosure and exploitation of the results, and to reward innovation. And all this should be done with, in providing flexibility to fit the individual projects and partners. So how does EMI work in terms of call for proposal? As I mentioned, it supports collaborative research projects following an open call, competitive call, with a peer review process. And this peer review process is organized by independent experts. So regarding the funding will come from the European Commission, which will take care of funding academia, public organizations, small and medium-sized enterprises, as well as patient associations, regulatories, any other stakeholder which are not part of European Pharmaceutical Industry Association, which participate in form of in-kind contribution. This in-kind contribution could be in the way of persons which are dedicated to the project, technological platform, whatever is needed to really, make sure that all the competences and the expertise are needed for this, achieving the project, the goal of the project, are met. Okay. So this is more or less the overall structure of a project where, as I mentioned earlier, the EMI beneficiary of the applicant consortium are the patient association, the academic, SMEs, regulator, and so on, were eligible for receiving EMI GU funding, while the EFPR company as such will come their contribution as in-kind contribution. So this is more or less how the calls are organized at EMIGU. So as I mentioned, the research agenda, where the scientific priorities are more or less set. This priority constitutes at the end of the work the call for proposal. This call for proposal is, as I mentioned earlier, also put together by EFPA Consortium. This EFPA Consortium works closely with the Executive Office, EMI Office, for finalizing the call and launching the call. So last Friday, I think it was 22nd of October, we launched the third call for proposal with the aim of receiving the expression of interest from the applicant consortium and organizing a first peer review on this expression of interest, and finally make sure that we select the first best expression of interest, which will then be invited to join the full project proposal with the EFPA consortium. So at this stage of the first evaluation, peer review evaluation, the coordinator of the call topic will be present during the evaluation. They need to explain really to our expert panel how exactly the call has been put together and what are exactly their needs, what they are really looking for. This to make sure that the expression of interest answers the call topic. But they do not participate, this EFPA coordinator, do not participate neither to the scoring nor to the ranking of the best expression of interest. So when this first expression of interest is selected, it's invited to form a consortium with the EFPA companies and to put together joint forces for the full project proposal, which will then be evaluated for a second peer review. And the successful full project proposal will be able to sign the grant agreement, which is really a document which binds EMIGU with the consortium, AFPR and academic, while the project agreement is really conditioned. They put together a condition and the outline, how they are going to work together, the EFPR companies with the other consortium applicant. So this is more or less the first proposal, the first call for proposal, and the different topics which were published and the different projects which are running right now. So we have four projects in the sector of safety, with research in carcinogenesis, non-genous toxic carcinogenesis. We have another project on ETOX, which is really the system for in silico toxicity prediction. We have safety, which is again a very big project in the domain of safety, which is a qualification of translational safety biomarkers. And the last one, PROTECT, which is in fact coordinated by EMR, which is the European Medicine Agency, which is really working on strengthening and monitoring the risk benefits. Then we have something like eight other projects which are running in the field of efficacy, with projects which runs from, here you have European Neuroscience, you have eMedia, which is in the domain of diabetes, so metabolic disease with Summit, and other which runs in the domain of respiratory disease like Ubiopred or Proactive. And finally, we have here four other projects which are running in the domain of education and training, with this M-Train project, which has really the main role, which is to put a catalogue together of all the existing courses in the domain of drug development process to make sure that the student could navigate within this jungle which is offered with different programs, and make sure to identify the right one which fits their needs. So Safe Summit is a program on safety.